Hey, what's up, everybody? It's Mark Ennis, a.k.a. Shark, the PA announcer and DJ from your Savannah Bananas, and you are watching the Legends on Deck podcast with hosts Brian Koss and David Condi.
An old cowboy went riding out one dark and windy day. Up on a ridge he rested as he went along his way. When all at once a mighty herd of red-eyed cows he saw, plowing through the ragged skies, and up a cloudy draw. Their brands were still on fire and their hooves were made of steel. Their horns were black and shiny.
Welcome to episode 70 of the Legends on Deck podcast. I'm Brian Koss, along with my co-host, David Condi. First, we'd like to note that our official sponsors of today's podcast are Southwest Concrete of Fort Myers and Hayden Supply of Fort Myers. They've been very helpful with David's travel ball team down in the Fort Myers, Southwest Florida area. We thank them for that. For sure. You guys have been off to a good start there, getting used to, well, at least you've been off to a start with your program and getting the Legends on Deck name out on the field. So,
yeah, the winning will come later. It's the development always has to start someplace. So we're trying to develop them into travel ball players, get away from the whole mindset of rec ball. And I think if these group of kids can stay together for a few years, I think at that point you'll see, we'll get some wins under the program. Right now, we just want to make sure that, you know, they understand the game at this level and get ready for high school as well.
Well, it's been very cool to see you get that program off the ground.
Yeah.
So it is Independence Day week, and we thought it would be appropriate that we get into a little baseball history this week. It's kind of our thought process. We cover a lot of topics and wide range of baseball on this program and on our website, a lot of modern stuff. But one of the things about baseball is its rich history in the United States, in all pockets of the country. And today we're going to welcome a baseball historian of sorts, Mr. Scott Brown of the Mordecai Brown Legacy Foundation. Scott, we'll get into it in a little bit, but Scott has been a friend of the program for a while. Scott, welcome to the show.
Gentlemen, I am honored to be here today. Thanks for having me.
You bet.
So the first question we ask all our guests is just kind of getting the background of, you know, where did you grow up? What brought you interested into the game of baseball? And how did that evolve into what you're kind of doing today? So kind of give us a backdrop of everything.
So I was born and raised in Southwest Ohio, roughly about 50 miles north of Cincinnati, 25 miles west of Dayton. I had just the privilege of growing up in kind of like a Norman Rockwell type of setting. I grew up on a 279 acre farm, cows, sheep, corn, wheat, beans, that type of thing. Our lane was a quarter of a mile long, and the house that I lived in at that time, when I lived in it back in the early 70s, was 155 years old. And town, as it was just a few miles up the road, and my school sat on the top of the hill, basically about a half a mile from my house. So it's just one of those situations where, you know, you grow up and you look back and you realize what a privilege it was to be a part of Americana in that time in our nation. And I don't take that for granted. But what was unique about that area also, it was a hotbed for baseball. And so I can go a little farther with that. But the reality is, you know, I grew up in the perfect all-American boy setting with the advantages of the game at my front door.
Awesome. So what inspired you to involve yourself in the historical part of baseball?
Well, being in the area in Southwest Ohio during the latter part of the 60s, the early 70s, the burgeoning what would become the big red machine was a part of our everyday life. As I mentioned, you know, we live 50 miles north of Cincinnati, which was an easy drive to get to either Crosley Field or later Riverfront Stadium. And, you know, Cincinnati was one of those markets, and still is really one of those small MLB markets where the players, the franchise, the stadium facilities are close to the heart of the people around them. When I was coming up and the big red machine was the big red machine at Riverfront Stadium, you know, they would take batting practice where you could actually get right up next to the cages. And so as a kid going to Riverfront, you know, you could see Rose and Bench and Morgan take their cuts. And these were guys that were out in the community as well. You know, Bench had a restaurant. Rose was from Cincinnati. You know, he did a lot of community things around. But the guys that weren't even from Cincinnati or even America became part of the region as well, whether it was Cesar Geronimo or Dave Concepcion. You know, these guys were a part. They would visit high schools and colleges and middle schools around our area. And it was the fabric. And again, looking back on that, I realize now that being a part of that community, having the franchise itself so much a part of our region, was really my basis and love for coming into the history, because you weren't just sharing in that which was at the moment for that season. You were sharing in the history of the franchise. And of course, the Cincinnati Reds being the oldest MLB franchise, our history was rich. And it was shared with everyone. We had a saying back during that time that, you know, you either followed, loved, and adored the big red machine, or you found somewhere else to live.
I guess that could be said. I guess it could be said for like the Yankees, right? You either follow the Yankees in the Bronx or you don't live there. You know, I'm not a Yankee fan, I'm a Met fan, but I'm just saying.
You're a Met fan, that's right, yeah.
Yeah, I definitely can appreciate what you're saying there. I've attempted something new here with Legends on Deck. Most of you guys that have watched previous episodes see usually the back of my shutters in one of the rooms of my house. I've tried to do a little baseball setup today, redone part of my front room to accommodate it. Not quite there. Still working on my camera. So if you're not lit, if you're watching, it might be a little blurry to you, but Scott, what Scott mentioned about going to Riverfront, I've got Tiger Stadium in the background here, so I could appreciate his affinity for baseball history when it comes to you know, in this case, I got to go to I was a little bit young to see a real good Tigers team, but I was able to appreciate the history through the ballpark. And growing up going to games at Tiger Stadium. So, and we share a manager as well.
With Absolutely. Sparky Anderson. We do. Sparky Anderson.
That's right. That's right. So I just wanted to give a little bit of background about Scott and his, kind of relationship with us at Legends on Deck. So going back, I would say it's over a year now. When I met Scott last summer, Scott and I both live in the Winter Garden, Florida area, and we worked on an event together last summer, which I believe was episode, I don't remember what episode it was now, David, but we recorded a live podcast at that event with Johnny Damon. I think it was episode 50, actually. So we're at 70 now, and Scott and I live in the Winter Garden area. We both are friends of the Winter Garden Squeeze. We had Adam on here a few episodes ago. And Scott and I talk frequently. And I think Scott and I are kind of like a little bit of a brain trust with the team as well. We appreciate finally having you on to talk about the things that you do, because it's been so interesting learning from Scott about all the research and the background that he has in baseball and the ideas that he has. So So I wanted to draw that connection and thank you for finally coming on.
Absolutely. This is good stuff.
Yeah. Yeah. So under that program that we had last year, it was part of the Mordecai Brown Legacy Foundation which Scott is the president of. They helped host the event. So I want to get into Mordecai Brown first. So if you could give us some background for those in our audience that may not know, he's a Hall of Famer, but who was Mordecai Three Finger Brown? And what is your connection with him? And he did write a book. Scott also wrote a book about his life. So I'm going to let you run with that a little bit.
So Mordecai Brown, those of you who are not familiar with this baseball player of note, was born in 1876. So we go back a few years. He actually broke into the game a little bit late in life. And I won't go deep into his history because I would love for you to read the book, or we would love for you to go to MordecaiBrown.com and learn a little bit more. But to give you a tidbit, he was basically physically challenged. At the age of 5 years old, his hand, which would become his dominant pitching hand, his right hand, he caught his finger in a feed chopper on his uncle's farm and was taken off. And while it was dressed and being set for healing, he had an accident, and which when they unbandaged everything, found out that it damaged his middle finger and had some nerve damage to his ring finger. So when his hand came out, the only working digits that were perfect on his hand were his thumb and his pinky. So he had this missing digit, twisted middle finger, and nerve damaged ring finger. And he learned the game of baseball from older gentlemen that worked in the coal mines around his home in Niceville, Indiana. And as I say, broke into the game late in life. But Mordecai Brown had a little bit of a uniqueness in that not only did he have a damaged pitching hand, but he had what we would call dead reckoning. Mordecai had the ability to understand where to place a pitch before it was even thrown. He practiced his craft, as it were, on the family farm, standing 60 feet 6 inches from the barn or the smokehouse and knocking out knot holes in the boards. And, you know, kind of akin to Johnny Bench's dad nailing a coffee can to the side of a barn and him throwing balls from the squatting position into that coffee can. And, you know, he had this uniqueness, this ability that turned into what would become a Hall of Fame career. We'll get more into his career, I'm sure, in a few minutes. But my kinship to him is he's a family member. He's a first cousin. And unfortunately, even though I had an affinity and a passion and a love for the game of baseball growing up, my portion of the family did not know that we were related to Mordecai until later on in life. So I did not grow up knowing that I had a connection to a Hall of Fame baseball pitcher. It was later on that we found the connection out. And what was really interesting was that the knowledge of Mordecai being a family member brought two sections of our family that had parted a few generations prior. Not in a bad way. People just moved on and didn't stay connected as they do today. And so the Kentucky, Ohio, and Indiana portions of the family were all brought back together because of Mordecai Brown. And it was unique when we came back together because of my relationship with baseball and the family members that were really taking care of the legacy and legend of what was and is Mordecai Brown were growing older themselves. And so we, as we brought the family together, realized that there was a need to collaborate and bring something greater into the picture. Mordecai being a Hall of Famer, like most Hall of Famers, regardless of what their popularity status are used for licensing and various things. And so we decided to not only keep the legend and legacy of Mordecai Brown alive, to continue his personality and his works while he was alive, but also to preserve the legalities of his name and his likeness. And so we formed the Mordecai Brown Legacy Foundation with a desire to help certain portions of the athletic and literary society, Again, we'll talk about that more in a minute. But it actually serves to give Mordecai an opportunity to get back out into the public, to be able to proclaim his overcoming story, and just to be a part of the fabric of baseball in a never-ending way. And so Mordecai Brown has not only been just a joy for me to serve his legacy, but also he has been a family blessing in bringing members of the family back together. We are a greater, larger Brown family because of Mordecai Brown.
Well, that's a great story, actually.
I want to ask you a question. Does it feel like? I guess you share a little bit of what it felt like to know that he was part of your family, but to really research and write a book about his life, what can you share, like the thoughts behind the research behind it and just writing the book itself, like knowing that this is a family member? I guess you kind of put a different thought process into it, right? If you just write about someone you don't really know, right? You didn't really know him, but you knew that he was part of your family. So when you researched everything, how inspired were you to do that?
So when Mordecai's story is one of overcoming, and we realized that needed to be told also along with his achievements on and off the field. And not having him as a part of my childhood actually became an advantage when we began researching and writing. I co-wrote Three Finger, the Mordecai Brown story, along with another family member, my cousin, Cindy Thompson, who is a well-established writer in other areas. This was both of our first baseball biography and history story. And we decided to do two things that I would never advise any other burgeoning author. Trying to write in one voice with another person, regardless of how close they are to you, and trying to write about something that is that close as like a family member. It can be difficult, but we decided from the beginning that through our research, regardless of what we found, regardless if there was some type of, not so great information, that we would continue on and press forward and divulge all so that we could write Mordecai's full story. When we began researching, fortunately at that time, there were people still alive that knew Mordecai well, whether they had been involved with him in baseball life or family members. And so we had a lot of firsthand information. We also had the advantage of having a number of newspapers and media outlets that were really behind our idea of gathering information. They helped us pepper the countryside, as it were, with asking for information. And so through that, we received wonderful letters and notes from older gentlemen and even ladies who had met Mordecai when they were younger, and they were able to recount their experience with him firsthand. I remember one of the most precious letters that I received was from a gentleman who was a veteran and was living in a Masonic retirement home somewhere in middle Indiana. And he wrote me this very shaky handwritten letter because he'd seen an article by Mark Bennett in the Terre Haute Tribune Star that we were looking for information. And he wrote me this 2-page letter, which I still have, about how his father owned a gas station out in the middle of nowhere. And on a Sunday drive, Mordecai pulled up to the gas station and filled up his tank. And I guess this gentleman, as a young man, had his baseball mitt on him at all times, rolled up and stuffed in his back pocket, as we used to do. And Mordecai noticed that, of course, and started asking him about baseball. Well, he spent time with the young man, which was very much a part of Mordecai's personality, talking about the boy's love for baseball and giving him a couple of stories of his own and giving him then what was always the Mordecai Brown trait: a couple of pointers in the game and a couple of pointers in life. And he said he had never forgot that. I have heard that story repeated over and over and over many times about people who interacted with Mordecai. One of the most special was from Carl Erskine. Carl Erskine talked about his meeting with Mordecai when he was a young ball player and just basically said the same thing. He spent time with me. He gave me instruction. And in hours' time, he coached me into things that lasted a lifetime. And so we knew when we heard those stories that we needed to bring out the Mordecai Brown story. And gentlemen, fortunately, I can say this, not as a family member, not as the president of the foundation, but as an author, we found nothing of ill report. We were able to tell the Mordecai Brown story in its fullness with regaling, just as I shared with you, about a man who had an overcoming experience in life and shared that with everyone that he met.
Wow. Oh, that was, I'm sure that was a bit refreshing.
Very much so.
That's awesome.
I think the worst thing we ever heard was when he kind of held out for a higher salary one season and stretched him out a week longer than they would have wanted. You know,
he was able to maybe pay his bills that week. Possibly. Yeah, so that season, those guys didn't make a whole lot.
Hey, baseball has to be interesting in some part of it, right? You have to still have some mystery in the game. So
that's right.
So beyond just researching and writing the book, you also set up the foundation in his honor, the Mordecai Brown Legacy Foundation. Mm-hmm. What is the mission of the foundation and what cause does it aim to support?
So we have two approaches to what we do that really are summed up in the same goal. The first approach is the dream, believe, succeed approach, where we really help those in the game of baseball and in life finding out what their dream is. What is it that you have on your heart to achieve? And how can we bring you into an understanding of a belief of that to succeed forward? And we partner people with situations and resources to bring their dream forward, whether that's playing baseball at any level, or succeeding in business. We also have a publishing arm. So we love to take young or unproven authors and work them from concept to publishing. We really enjoy doing that. We also have a saying, I guess, or a motto that we have used for years, which is excellence over adversity, which we took from Mordecai and his overcoming. And so oftentimes we find people that have loved his story of overcoming, have loved his story of achievement, and ask, you know, how can I overcome my inability, disability, disadvantage? And so we work with people, again, predominantly in the sports world and that of baseball, but we've helped a lot of others outside. Because of Mordecai's nature and because of my own and those that serve the foundation, you know, I'll find myself sitting down to a cup of coffee with a young man or a young lady and her family and talking about, you know, a dream that they're looking towards. And they always start out with all the reasons they can't. So one of the things that the Mordecai Brown Legacy Foundation is about is finding the can. And, you know, if we can change your mindset, if we can change your heart set on focusing on your dream, we can achieve it. And we is really you, but sometimes it needs a little inspiration. And we found that was what Mordecai always did, regardless of what season of life he was in. He was about inspiring others. Again, we've got stories, you know, in the book and even beyond the book of Mordecai helping, you know, young ball players and young broadcasters and photographers and business people in the Chicago or New York area or central Indiana where he lived. We've got stories of you know, men like Dizzy Dean coming to him as he was beginning his own coaching career after his playing days, coming to Mordecai for advice. You know, we find, as I mentioned, Carl Erskine before, you know, hearing from Mordecai when he was just busting into the 3i league before his days with Brooklyn, and Mordecai inspiring him within 1 hour of their time together in lessons that Carl took all throughout life in baseball and beyond. And so that's what we aspire to do, is encourage others forward into their dream. We do that through one-on-one meetings. We do that through team gatherings. We do that through providing resources. As Brian mentioned earlier, he and I are involved with the Winter Garden Squeeze, which is a summer Wood Bat League here in Central Florida. But as a foundation, we're involved with a lot of summer wood bat leagues around the nation because we find that to be incredibly, wonderfully grassroots baseball. And if we can provide coaching resources, life coaching resources to the players, we can provide wood bats with teams that have little to no budget. We can inspire forward with advice towards building a better stadium or better, area for fans, whatever that might be. We love to inspire and work forward towards the dream.
You know, that's kind of, it's awesome that Mordecai Brown, I mean, his legacy of playing baseball and in that time frame, so many decades later, he's just inspiring so many more people in the game. You know, it would have been amazing if he obviously would been lived long enough to see part of that. So what you're doing with your family's legacy, I think it's amazing. It's going to last for decades to come.
Without getting spooky, we feel that Mordecai is still living forward from whatever, the other dimension allows us to see into this one. I don't know, but we do feel his presence on a regular basis. And that keeps us rolling forward in staying on point to what he designed in his life. You know, I think if the ability to form a foundation as we have was something that he could have done back, that he would have done that, because even though it wasn't officialized under a 501c3, Mordecai did everything that we're doing on his own and with his family. You know, I didn't mention this, but Mordecai had no children of his own. He and his wife had no children. And so it's been left up to nephews and cousins and nieces and others in the family to carry forward. And, you know, while I hate that he had no offspring to carry on, you know, the literal Mordecai Brown name, the Brown family name has been carried forward because of him and because of others that have had that same personality. So in very much a real sense, Mordecai had no biological children, but he has hundreds and hundreds and hundreds.
Yeah. Yeah. No, that's, I mean, I think it's a very unique story. I mean, if you study a little baseball history, I know the name was familiar to me when I met you. Because when I was a kid, I used to flip through this Cooperstown Hall of Fame book all the time and read the profiles. I couldn't say I was a Mordecai Brown expert, but at least familiar with the name. But I would say the vast majority of baseball fans don't go that far back into our memory, our collective memory there. So it's good to kind of reconnect that legacy, his career and legacy, and bring it into modern times. So. Great work you guys are doing.
Well, I encourage others to read the book, not just because we're trying to sell books. I mean, it's been out for a great number of years, but because we find that people can locate themselves within the pages of the Mordecai Brown story. Cindy and I took it for writing each chapter based on one of his monikers or one of his nicknames, which he had a number of them. His best known, of course, is Three Finger, which was not politically correct due to his handicap. But, people come from difficulty. You know, people come from hard beginnings. He was called Miner because he worked in the coal mines in Western Indiana as a young man. People come from humble beginnings where they don't have a lot, but they work their way up. He was called the Royal Rescuer because of his pitching, not only as a front pitching ace for the Cubs and the Reds, but also as a reliever. And sometimes, you know, you can be as powerful in the second position as you can in the first. And so as we walk through those nicknames, people find themselves in the pages. One of my favorites, though, is the one that most of us have always carried at some point in our lives with our last name, and that's Brownie. And that was the friend, Mordecai Brown. And that's, I think, one of the most incredible things that he ever did. He was a friend to whomever he met. And I think it sets a pace, especially in today's society, where we meet a lot of strangers, but we don't walk away as friends. And I think it's a good lesson. So I encourage you folks to read it and find yourself in the pages of Three Finger, the Mordecai Brown story.
You bet we will. I'm going to be adding it to the library here soon. I did add this other one to the library, though, recently. I'm going to shift a little bit over to your second book, which is Baseball in Pensacola. I went and grabbed this off my shelf here. Baseball in Pensacola. So you grew up in the Cincinnati, Dayton area, outside Southwest Ohio. But at some point in life, and I don't know exactly when, you moved to Pensacola, Florida. Pensacola, for those that don't know, I'm in Orlando, David's in Cape Coral, which is Southwest. Pensacola is way to the northwest side of the panhandle of Florida, Alabama border, right? So you end up over there and you get involved in the history of baseball in Pensacola. You bring together some community partners and you get involved. Eventually, you guys bring minor league baseball back to town. So I'd like to tell us a little of this story, your migration to Pensacola and what you guys were able to do over there.
So in the latter part of 1979, my father moved us to Pensacola. There was a college that he wanted to attend. And so literally picked the family up from outside the Dayton area where I was raised and moved us to Pensacola. He moved his business Lock, Stock, and Barrel there as well. So we became part of the Pensacola community. And Pensacola had has an incredible history to it. It's called the City of Five Flags because, you know, it's an American city. So that's one. It was part of the Confederacy. So that's two. But vying throughout its history from its very early beginnings in the 1500s, Spain, Britain, and France fought over that area. And so it changed flags frequently. So there's a rich, rich, rich history to Pensacola. There are two existing of four existing forts on the coast there. That they have the Pensacola Naval Air Station, which is one of the largest air training centers for the Navy outside of San Diego. Their history just goes deeper and deeper and deeper. And that's very well marketed. It's progressed into a historical village in downtown Pensacola. They're very proud of their history. But what I found as a lover of the game of baseball, found that they also had an incredibly rich, diverse history in the game, starting back to 1870, 1868, actually. And nobody had ever written about it. Nobody had ever really promoted it. And so I just felt that someone should. And I tapped myself on the shoulder and said, "You're someone." So began my research. And what I found, the onion wasn't that hard to peel. The layers of baseball history, those involved in Pensacola, came out of the woodwork in every aspect, from just local boys making it to the show, to the military, to historical ball players playing in and around Pensacola. And what I found very quickly was Pensacola was a hotbed for the game of baseball. And they have a very, very long list of players who have made it not only to minor league level, but to the major league level. Don Sutton being the only Hall of Famer from that area, but their list of players from Jay Bell to Kevin Sauché to Travis Fryman. I mean, it just goes on and on and on. Adron Chambers. And the depth there of just local boys making it good was enough to write a book about. But then when you pull in the military from the World War II and Korean days, where you have guys like Bobby Kennedy and Ted Williams playing baseball on the shores of Pensacola, to Babe Ruth and Jackie Robinson going through in minor league games, it just continued to unravel. So fortunately, Pensacola, in being such in love with its history, has an incredible archive and incredible historical society. So there was a lot of things that were preserved, but had never seen the light of day. So we begin to build on that and interview. And what was really interesting at that time when I began researching the book is Pensacola had been a location for not only spring training starting back in 1913 all the way up through the 1960s. It had also been a location for a number of franchised minor league teams. And that had been Pensacola's really love up through the 60s, had a stadium right down on Pensacola Bay. You could see the water. But after about 1962, that had come to a screeching halt, and we had not had any professional baseball in Pensacola since 1962. And we had a gentleman from outside of the Pensacola area who had purchased a independent baseball team called the Pensacola Pelicans that were playing at one of our local universities. And the fans, as they had always done with teams in Pensacola, whether spring training or local teams that were involved in southern leagues around our region, came out in droves. Now, that was for baseball mainline or even going through the Negro League days. And it didn't matter whether you were white or black, both showed up to the ballpark no matter who was playing. We basically broke the color barrier in Pensacola long before Jackie Robinson because of our passion for baseball. That's a story in itself. But there's a love for the game in Pensacola, but no real professional baseball. And so the independent league was the closest thing. With fans turning out, they were overflowing the stands and realized there was a need for something larger. So Quint Studer, the owner of the team, began to strategize on building a larger stadium on the water once again in Pensacola. During that time was when I had begun my research for the book. Unbeknownst to me, our local PBS station was putting together information for a documentary to follow up on Ken Burns' success with the 10th inning of his baseball series. And the producer of that show came to the GM of our local independent team and said, I've got to write this script for this, and I have two problems. I know nothing about the history of baseball in Pensacola, and I know nothing about baseball in itself. Can you help me? And he said, I've got just the guy. So as I began my research, so was PBS at the same time, and they pulled us together. And I had the privilege and the fortune of doing both simultaneously together. And so interviews that we did for the documentary, I was able to use for the book. Information that I was gathering with the book, I was able to lend to the documentary. And so what happened, baseball in Pensacola became the book that you're holding in your hand, Brian, as well as a 2.5-hour documentary that we did, again, simultaneously. Anybody who's interested in Northwest Florida baseball or Florida baseball or baseball history in general, I would encourage you to get the book and the documentary because they cover some of the same aspects, but they bring it out in a different way. And there's a lot of information in both. And we just had such a joy doing that. And that was completed and finished on the heels of the first inaugural season of the Pensacola Blue Wahoos AA baseball team that was actually ended up coming into that stadium. That's a whole story in itself about how an indie team became a AA affiliate. But the Cincinnati Reds were the home franchise for that club at that time. And we were able to complete the book, complete the documentary, and bring that into raising the fan level for Pensacola again. And that 5,000 plus seat auditorium stays filled every single game. It's on the bay. Every side has a view of the water. It is one of the best venues in minor league baseball. And fortunately, I do get to go back and see a game every now and again. And I was just there a few months ago and ran into Quint Studer, the owner, and he grabbed me and hugged me. And he said, Scott, I can't tell you. He goes, your book, the documentary, he said, help make this happen. And he says, you know, this is, you're a part of this. And so that's a privilege to be involved at that level. So I've had some fun in my writing, whether it was as a, you know, Mordecai as a family member and finding out that he wasn't a schmo, that he was a really good guy, or helping raise the fan base of a city who really deserved a professional team?
That's fantastic. And how do we get it? Two follow-ups. One, how do we get a hold of the documentary?
So the book and the documentary can both be purchased on Amazon.
You can get the documentary on Amazon.
I believe you still can. If not, it can be purchased from the Pensacola Blue Wahoos souvenir shop or WSRE PBS for the Gulf Coast in Pensacola, Florida.
Gotcha. Okay. So yes, I did find this on Amazon. But I'll have to look for the documentary as well. And my second follow-up is really from a research side. So you come into Pensacola, want to dig into the history of it. Where do you go? How did you start with all that?
So for me, that's a fun process. And so I'll take this from a standpoint of anybody else that wants to write about their town or a specific ball player or aspect of the game. Treat it as a treasure hunt. Treat it as a treasure hunt. You know, your local library or historical society that has archives from your area is a good place to start, because what you're going to do is you're going to find situations and names that you need to follow up on. And just like, a treasure hunt or a detective story, you know, follow the leads. And if you find names that you know, maybe even the person may not be living again, you know, find their family and pull out information. And you will find people that will desire to talk about their history, their family's history, their region's history. One of the things that I so enjoyed that was not touched on in any aspect was writing about the Negro Leagues within Pensacola. That, I mean, we're talking an incredible baseball system that lasted for decades and decades and decades. And what I had the opportunity to do was follow that methodology of going in and finding names, finding the families that still existed. And Brian, David, I was brought into people's homes, sat down on their couches with a tall glass of lemonade and regaled stories about people's husbands or fathers or uncles and about the achievements that they did and how even though they didn't have all the resources that, you know, the mainline white teams had, you know, were traveling from Pensacola all the way to San Francisco to play against, what would have been major league, if you will, major league, Negro League teams. And so, you know, just to be able to hear their history and them share their pictures and things, for any researcher, that's the gold mine, is to find those people that still know. Find the firsthand experiences if you can. But the reality is you have to get out. You're going to have to go to some places that you know, maybe once had a ball field, maybe once had some type of training area, maybe, and dig a little bit. You are the Indiana Jones of baseball history. You've got to dig and uncover and find it. But I'm telling you, the treasures are there. They're rich. This is America's game. And so you're going to find what you need. Then expand out into your state archives. And I cannot say this and stress this enough. Our National Baseball Hall of Fame is one of the greatest resources that you will ever tap into. Their library and extensive archives are the place to go. You'll find baseball museums, whether dedicated to a team or a region or a player, dotted throughout our nation. Those are good too. But I can't stress enough, Cooperstown is the place. If you can make it there, it will open up doors for you. We, as the Brown family, have donated much of everything that really is informational to Cooperstown on Mordecai, because we know there's going to be others that'll come behind us and utilize that. It's a good depository. When I finished all of my research for baseball in Pensacola, I donated all of my research information to the Pensacola Historical Archives, because I know there's going to be people that come behind me that will use that. So utilize your local, regional, and national museums and archives. It's a great place to start.
You know, I think that's a
great advice.
it's awesome that, you know, my next question was kind of delving into what it takes to write a baseball book. And I think you just touched on a lot of that. It's just, you know, research in different cities where baseball started or where baseball teams have been or, you know, or players have come from, and being able to understand the aspect. Everyone knows about the big teams that are out there right now, but how many people really know about the small teams that started and created legacies in towns and grew to bigger things? So just kind of researching the research that you do and the kind of looking into it, all that, it's, I think it really kind of bring the true baseball fan back to the love of the game and not just what it is right now, but what it, where it started at.
You can find any aspect of our culture and society within our game, the game of baseball. I don't care whether it's racial, social, political, emotional, psychological. There's every aspect of the American person, the American populace within our game. So if there's something that you are interested in that you want to write about, it's within the game. And you can find, I don't say that just to fluff anybody's ears or gloss it over, but I'm telling you that this is a cross-section of who we are. And if you follow the history of the game, you will follow the history of America from 1876 forward, I guarantee you. And so there's an opportunity here for baseball to be used as a catalyst for writing any aspect of our society. You know, David, Brian, I'm gonna throw this out here. I may get myself in a little bit of trouble, but it's because of what I do and because of what we do through the foundation. We do have a publishing arm. We do help young and burgeoning authors. If there's anyone listening to this program that is interested in writing the history of baseball in any segment, and you'd like to be encouraged and go forward, reach out to us. Reach out to us through the Mordecai Brown Legacy Foundation website. Reach out to us through the podcast here. They can connect you to me. I'll be happy to have a conversation with you to get you going forward in what you need to be a success in writing the story that's inside of you right now. And every single one of us has a story that needs to be written.
Excellent. Absolutely. That's great. You know, it's funny. You were talking about the Negro League team. For some reason, I opened the book right to the page of the team.
That's one of them right there. Yeah, that's the Pensacola Gulls, Seagulls.
The Gulls, I believe.
Pensacola Seagulls, yeah.
And you were talking about their trip to San Francisco, and this exact picture talks about their trip to San Francisco. So,
hey, real quick, I'll just share this quick story. During the time of the Seagulls back in the 50s and 60s, I mean, they were an incredible team, and they shared space at our local stadium called Legion Field, and the Pensacola Flyers played at certain times of the week, and the Pensacola Seagulls played, and the races intermingled because they had their favorite players on both. And like I said, that was a place that broke the color barrier. But what was interesting was the Pensacola Flyers bus was this old rickety thing that had holes in the bottom of it, and they had to stuff paper in it to keep the rain from coming up if they were driving the rain. The Seagulls bus was new, pristine, and had actual air conditioning back in the late 50s. But this was a segregated team that actually continued up until 1982. They continued, the Pensacola Seagulls. They integrated, and they actually had white players come in. Greg Litton, who played for the San Francisco Giants, had some of his first experiences in professional baseball playing for the Pensacola Seagulls Negro League team.
That's very unique history for sure. That's a very cool story. I just think that when you put a work together like this, and the Mordecai Brown story, of course, both, when I look at it, and David may be thinking the same thing, it looks both fun and overwhelming, right? So can you give us an idea, what kind of time frame did it take you to get these done, for example, like this book and the research that you put into publishing this book? What years was that approximately between?
I started pulling research in for baseball in Pensacola in 2009, but that was just some cursory type of things, just, you know, some fact finding. Really started pulling together interviews in 2010. The inaugural year was 2013 for the Pensacola Blue Wahoos, and so we were published and ready to go by that time. So it was about a good two and a half years of research and writing. Now, you have to understand, this was not something I was doing full time.
Yes,
you know, I was doing evenings after my regular job. You juggle family in there. So it really depends on the individual, what kind of time they can spend, whether traveling for research or actually sitting down to write it. But the biggest part of it is dedication. You know, you have to understand that if you have a dream and you want to see that dream come into reality, you're going to have to stay with it. Stay with it is an individual definition. You know, how much time you put into it.
Sure. Well, David and I can appreciate that as baseball writers. Both of us have to find ways to discipline ourselves to, you know, publish articles on a regular basis, to organize podcasts with guests and all that. So we can appreciate that even though we haven't done something on a research level like this, we've done, you know, we do our articles and our podcasts on a regular basis. So it does require, time and discipline to get that done. So we admire what you've done there.
I encourage others to put some type of markers in there for the goal to say, okay, I want to get it done by. Mine actually put a couple of people that were subjects within the book as my goal, one being Johnny Joe Lewis. Johnny Joe Lewis was the first African-American major leaguer out of Pensacola. He hit the majors in 1964 with the St. Louis Cardinals. Johnny had an incredible career with the Cardinals and the Mets, David, not only a player, but a hitting coach, a mentor. He was very well known in aspects, as was Mordecai Brown. He was a friend to players. A lot of players give credit to their ability on the field because of Johnny Joe Lewis. He started in the Negro Leagues and came up, broke out of that into the major leagues. Quite a story. He was one of my marker goals. I wanted to get the book out and ready that would come before what was to be the decline of Johnny with some health issues. And so we were able to do that. And he was able to enjoy seeing his story and being a part of some of the old timers gatherings that came on the heels of this publication. And I had the fortunate opportunity to deliver Johnny's eulogy at his funeral. And, standing in the midst of flowers that were sent by, I won't mention names because that's a little private, I think, for him. But, you know, some of the greatest notables of the game that are on the halls of Cooperstown. And to be able to stand there as really a nobody and deliver the life story of this great man was an honor. And I think that probably was even greater than seeing my book on the shelf of local bookstores.
Well, that's awesome. Well, Scott, with that, I think we're going to start wrapping it up.
But I got to make one point.
I got a million questions that we could probably go on all day, but go ahead, David.
I got to make one point because I was looking this up.
Yes, go ahead.
I was looking up the Pensacola Blue Wahoos. I wanted to look at this stadium.
Yeah.
And I found one thing very interesting, which I don't think is any stadium in America is doing. They're on Airbnb.
Yes.
And they rent one night. It's like $5,000, but you have up to 10 guests. You get one bedroom, 10 beds, 3 baths. They're bunk beds. So it's like 2 queen beds, 4 bunk beds. You get a bay view. You get free parking on the premises, air conditioner. You get a hair dryer and a microwave. You get Wi-Fi. You get a TV standard with cable. I'm not watching TV, but I'm sleeping in a stadium. You get a patio and a balcony, refrigerator, and then you get extensive security to watch you while you're there. But there's 20 other amenities. I don't know if you get a baseball game with this, But imagine, I mean, this, I'm looking at the stadium. It's awesome. It's on the bay. It's beautiful. It's just like its own little platform there. So imagine being able to sleep in a baseball stadium, historic baseball stadium, for one night. It is not cheap, but I'm sure it would be an experience in itself. To find it on Airbnb, I thought it was a joke, but it's not. You can actually rent it.
Yes, you can.
Which is amazing.
Well, yeah. Well, maybe that's a Legends on Deck convention or something. Well, with that, I think we're going to start wrapping it up. Scott, we appreciate both, you know, your storytelling and your insight as a writer and a baseball historian. And we'll certainly have many conversations over the next few months and years ahead. And we look forward to having you back on again at some point.
Would love to. Thanks, guys. It's been a joy.
Thank you. Appreciate it. And Brian, I want to end it. Go ahead with the launch page.
Yeah, it's fine. We'll just I just wanted to mention the merch page. I got a couple of new. This is a 4th of July sort of Independence Day version of our hats with our stars and stripes. David's wearing our that's not available in the shop, but if you want them custom ordered, David could get them for you. Those are his team hats.
Yeah. And we also have some recent articles on the website. Anybody want to check them out? You know, we've been rolling along here in the summertime, just writing all about baseball and sharing the many stories that are out there on the ball players and the teams and exciting season that's going on. And just got to end it with our sponsors mostly come on to help out with the travel ball teams. Once again, Southwest Concrete of Fort Myers, Hayden Supply of Fort Myers. They also were the uniform sponsors for the team. And these other sponsors that kind of helped out for the summer program, Channel Mark Pools, Ease It Mortgage, Paradise Found Home Watch out of Fort Myers. And we have Land Elite LLC, Hampton Manor, and Famous Philly Cheesesteaks out of Cape Coral, Florida, a big growing city out here in Cape Coral, Florida. We continue to grow. Great baseball is coming out of the city, and I hope to kind of help develop some ball players to come out of the city and become some great men in the game one day. But with that, we just want to thank, you know, Scott, for you coming on the show. Brian, 70, you know, we're 30 away from our goal of 100 that we set a year ago. We've had some amazing guests on here. You know, our followers get to see amazing people share their stories, and we just keep doing what we said we were going to do with the podcast. Is just kind of make it about our guests. And I'm honored to have Scott, you on the show today, and honored to share the story of Mordecai Brown, something that I really didn't know about. And now hearing about it and learning about it, I know I want to go out there and get the book and read more about it and kind of delve into it and get some historian, baseball historian into me and with my kids as well. So thank you for sharing that today.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you. So Legends on Deck, episode 70, signing off.